I mean, I know some. There are abundance of books on the subject. I don't like to just bring you what I read in somebody else's book. I like to bring you what I've gotten from the Lord. However, that's not always as easy as it sounds, because it wasn't last night. It was the night before last. All through the night, the Lord spoke to me about the Passover. And so I woke up and I didn't have a chance to write it all down. So I'm hoping it'll come out as the Lord leads here. But so basically what I'm going to be doing is really approaching this very different than all the other Bible schools and teachers that would do this. They would systematically. It's important to have knowledge of the Bible so the Holy Spirit can give you something wherewith he can reveal Christ. But I want to see Jesus, and I want you to see Jesus, and I want you to be conformed to his image. And these things, there are several approaches that people take. One is people just share the scriptures and the historical fact of what the feasts and offerings were, and they give you a lot of information. The other one is that they take the offerings and the feasts and they show how Jesus fulfilled that in the Gospels, and how he was the fulfillment of the Passover. He was, you know, he went in the triumphal entry 4 days before the thing on the 10th, which is when the lamb has to be chosen. And then he was crucified on the day of Passover. He was the lamb that was offered up. They inspected him, Pilate, Herod, they go into all that. They inspected him and found that the lamb had no spots or blemish. And but he was still slain, not because of sin, but as a sacrifice. And they get into all of that, and all that's really good. But in a sense, that still has no application to our lives, to us being the body of Christ, and therefore the fulfillment of this thing is taking place by Christ in us today even. We are the fulfillment of what that temple was. We are the fulfillment, and when I say we are, Christ is. But we are his body. And as such, through us, these things manifest themselves. And so, I have found, well, Paul said it best, knowledge puffs up. It just makes you think you're smarter than what you are. And then it makes you think everybody else is dumb if they don't know what you know. That's not even Christ-like, if much less that's not Christ. And we're not on a journey to be Christ-like. We want Christ formed in us. And so for that to take place, we have to see Jesus. And when we see Jesus, we will see, we will find our place. We will find our place. It's like when Isaac, who represented the true seed, as Galatians describes, these things, he says, Paul says in Galatians, these things are an allegory. Isaac representing the true seed, Ishmael representing the false. And Ishmael had his place. He was in the family. He was older than, he was as it were, the first man, Adam. He was a son. He was all that. And he had his place. But when God said, all right, Isaac is the heir, then Ishmael was put out. It wasn't just that Abraham came to the knowledge of what's wrong with Ishmael. Do you understand what I'm saying? We must see Jesus is what I'm saying. It's not enough to just see how bad you are. You know, Some of us have seen that in a really good way, or shall I say a really bad way. But that doesn't put Ishmael out. It just makes us wrestle with the flesh. It's when we see Jesus that Ishmael is put in his place because the seed is given his proper place as the heir. So, just like in that story, so all of these things, and just as that story has application for our lives right now today and is not just a picture sometime, 2,000 years ago when Jesus walked the earth, it's not just a picture that he fulfilled. It is a reality that he is yet the fulfillment and working in us. So these feasts and these offerings is meant to be a reality of Christ through his body and the living manifestation of it taking place in us. So, that said, I do want to start with talking about things relating to the Passover feast. You'll turn with me to Exodus chapter 12. Excuse me. Exodus chapter 12. And the whole 12th chapter basically deals with the Passover, the actual event of the Passover. There was 10 plagues that God sent using Moses before the Passover. That was, things like water turned to blood and frogs covering the land and gnats and flies and livestock being stricken, hail and fire, a plague of locusts. God sent all of these terrible things on Egypt and on Pharaoh. And even though, they're finding frogs in their bed, frogs in their food, and then that's over with, and they go to drink the water and it's turned to blood, and over and over and over. Nothing released Israel, no matter how horrible it was, until the death of the Lamb. Now, I want you to think about that, because we think that God is going to get what he wants by bringing judgment on somebody or something or a nation or whatever. We think that that's how he's going to accomplish his end. And he sent that on Pharaoh, and no, let my people go. No, Only when the lamb died. And you know what? The lamb wasn't a plague. Well, it wasn't to Israel. The lamb was a plague to Egypt. But it wasn't some horrible event that happened to the Egyptians. It was an event that happened to the lamb. He died. He gave his life. And so it shows us that no matter what God does or what happens, there is not going to be any deliverance, true deliverance, until we see the Lamb, until we see our death and our death with him. And we see that as such a reality that we are free from all that is Ishmael, all that is Pharaoh, all that is Egypt. I'm going to tell you can hear these things and believe them and still not be free. God doesn't want you to believe doctrinal things that are even true, the greatest truths of all. If it be the greatest truths of all, God's not interested in building a doctrinal people. He wants his son bringing freedom and liberty into our lives by his life in us. That's what he's after. That's what he desires. Not, not just setting us free. And if we believe, if we believe simply in God setting us free from something by doing a miracle, then we would believe God simply dealing with something by bringing a plague. We would believe in miracles and we would believe in plagues as the answer. We would believe in God honoring us with a miracle because we stayed true. Or we would believe in God punishing us with a plague because we messed up. God either sees you in Adam or Christ. You're either marked for death, and we all are, or you're marked for life, which is Christ in you. It's that simple. It's not that difficult in his mind. He doesn't have to get into all the details. We go, well, yeah, but I'm not doing good this week, so God's going to get me. To what end? I mean, if the Father's after his Son, to what end? Just to torment you? I mean, is he, okay, then now we have to consider what kind of God we have as Father. Is he just a tormentor? If so, then what makes him any different than the devil? Using torment to get your way when you can't do it with candy. But folks, it's not that he's trying to motivate us with a carrot out here that we follow and go, or a stick behind us that he whips us with. But rather to change our heart so that we do what we do by life alone. Now that, folks, that circumvents so much in truth it circumvents everything, but let me just say it circumvents so much in the natural. Because what that does is it causes you to live on a plane that does not exist off of, draw its motivation from, find its hope in the earth. It lives where he lives because it's one with him. Only because it's one. Not just lives where he is. It lives where he is because it has taken its place in oneness with Jesus, and it draws, it just doesn't draw from the earth. It draws from the true vine. It draws life and resources and patience and hope. It finds peace when there is no peace in the earth. You know, you're familiar with the scripture, peace, peace, when there is no peace. But are you also familiar with the scripture Jesus said, in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Well, it's good he's overcome it. And it's good for me if I'm one with the one who has overcome it. In other words, if he's overcome it, does that tell me that he has remedies that can help me to overcome? Is that what I get from that? Or does that tell me he's overcome it, and I never think in terms of separateness? I only think in terms of oneness. And if he's overcome it, I've overcome because I'm found in Christ. And that's that branches, whatever branch thinks that way, that's its reality. It never considers itself independent. That's why the term Christian is hard to deal with. You know, again, the term Christian, folks, was coined by outsiders, not by Christians, not by believers. Outsiders looked at them and called them Christians. You know, and the term's only used a couple of times in the New Testament. Because they looked and saw that they seemed to be citizens, like Ephesians, Corinthians, Christians, citizens of another kingdom. But it's more than being a citizen of another kingdom. You can believe you're a citizen of another kingdom and still be separate from the king in terms of oneness. He's your boss, but is he your everything? Is he your source? And do you look to that reality to in every situation, or do you step back from that and then find your own life again? You say, well, what does this have to do with feasts and offering? It has everything to do with it. It has everything to do with the Passover, and we'll get into that in just a minute. Let's go ahead and read in chapter 12. Let's just read verse 3. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. Now let's skip down to verse 6. And ye shall keep it unto the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper post of the houses wherein they shall eat. So this is the doorpost, okay? Picture it. Well, we don't have to picture. I'll draw it. Get me untangled here. Using my superior drawing ability. There's the door. Striking the blood here and here and here and here. Because that's where you enter in at. You know, if they were Catholics, they'd be doing something like, you know what I'm saying? They'd be doing the sign of the cross. And every one of them would be doing it. And people would be looking around going, are they Jews or Catholics? And so there is that, the first part of it, of the Feast of Passover, which is putting the blood on the doorpost, killing the lamb, but not just killing the lamb. Everybody believes, every believer, no matter what the denomination, and believes in killing the lamb. Few believe in eating the lamb. And they were not just told to kill it. They were told to eat it. It's a big, big leap there from what most people have. But then connected with that is also, under the heading of the Feast of Passover, is the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which on the 14th day, Nisan, which is the first, which they call the first day of the month at this juncture, it was made. On the 10th day, they chose the lamb. On the 14th day, they killed it at evening. On the 15th day to the 21st day was the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And I shared a little bit about leaven and its meaning in one of my last classes in the study of the priesthood. But I want to share a little on that again, but I want to take it a little further for you. I want you to see the reality of these things. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 16, where it describes this feast a little better for us. Now remember, it is still part of Passover. The 14th day at night, you eat the Passover lamb. The 15th day, you start the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Deuteronomy 16, and let's start at verse 2. Thou shalt therefore sacrifice the Passover unto the Lord thy God of the flock and of the herd, the place which the Lord shall choose to place his name there. Thou shalt eat no leavened bread with it. 7 days shalt thou eat unleavened bread therewith, even the bread of affliction, for thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt in haste, that thou mayest remember the day when thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt all the days of thy life. Let's see. Let's read the next verse. And there shall be no leavened bread seen with thee in all thy border 7 days. Neither shall there anything of the flesh which thou sacrificest the first day at evening remain all night until the morning. All right, so there was the day the lamb was killed, the night you eat it, the next day begins 7 days of making sure on that Passover night There is no leaven in your house. None. In fact, God, we're reading Deuteronomy here now. He said, not in all of your borders. Not in your house, not in your house, not in your house, not in your house. None. No leaven found anywhere. Now let's go to Numbers. Book of Numbers, chapter 33. And this is just confirming this. This is dealing with the fact that they came out of Egypt. What happened was on the 14th, they killed the lamb. They put the blood on the doorpost. They ate of it. And the next morning, they got up and went. And that's found in Numbers 33, verse 3. And they departed from Ramses in the first month on the 15th day. So that's the 14th day is when it was killed and eaten. The 15th day they rose up and left. On the 15th day of the first month, on the next day after the Passover, the children of Israel went out with a high hand in the sight of all the Egyptians. And the Egyptians buried all their firstborn, which the Lord had smitten among them upon their gods. Also, the Lord executed judgment. All right. So, you immediately, the first time, you see this thing of not just the death of the lamb, but at the same time that they're going out of Egypt, they're eating unleavened bread for 7 days. Now, we know that seven is the number of completion. So seven doesn't all, for example, let me just say it like this. For example, in the book of Revelation, the message to the seven churches does not mean that God, that Jesus only spoke to seven churches. Seven is the number of completion. It means that by it being seven, this is for all the churches. It's for everyone. It's a complete message to everyone. All right. Now, let's go to Joshua. Joshua chapter 5. We tend to read things not in light of the fulfillment of Christ, not in light of everything is pieced together very, very carefully by the Lord and has meaning. We tend to read things simply as just a new thing happened, or this is a new subject. But what we're going to read here is a very familiar scripture to some of you, especially you that have searched the scriptures and been around for a while. A very familiar scripture that we have a explanation for that, but we haven't seen that everything is fulfilled by the death and resurrection of Christ. And so we don't grasp the full meaning of it. And so in Joshua chapter 5 and verse 10, and the children of Israel encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at evening in the plains of Jericho. And they did eat of the old grain of the land on the next day after the Passover, unleavened cakes, parched grain, in the very same day. And the manna ceased on the next day after they had eaten of the old grain of the land. Neither had the children of Israel manna any more, but they did eat of the fruit of the land of Canaan that year. This isn't just a little story and a little statement of the fact that Israel went 40 years in the wilderness and manna fell from heaven. And God gave them manna and they continually ate it. But when they came into the land, they decided, hey, look, here's corn and here's stuff and here's wheat and everything. Let's eat this stuff now. And they ate it. And then God took care of them and didn't send manna anymore because the promised land, you know, had abundance. That's what most of the time we think. But if you look, it tells you plainly, and the children of Israel encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at evening in the plains of Jericho. And they did eat of the old grain of the land on the next day. That's the 15th day. That's the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After the Passover, unleavened cakes and parched grain in the very same day, and the manna ceased on the next day after they had eaten the old grain of the land. Neither had the children of Israel manna anymore, but they did eat of the fruit of the land of Cana that year. What this is speaking of is the fruit of the land of Cana is not just the blessing of God. The fruit of the land of Cana is 7 days or a completion. From here on out, you'll never eat of the old manna. You'll never eat of what you were used to before. You will now, from now on, eat unleavened bread. You have entered in to the feast as a lifestyle. You have entered into the feast of unleavened bread. And at a certain juncture, the old is cut off. And now let's go to the scripture that you're familiar with that I shared not too long ago out of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 6. Your glorying is not good. Know ye not. Don't you know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Now what he's saying here is not just the principle of how to make biscuits and using that as a really neat example. You know, yeah. You know, it's like I remember someone once saying, Jesus was so smart, he was a great teacher. Jesus would find an example. He'd be walking with his disciples and they would be walking along and he would look and see the wheat in the field and he would see that wheat and use that as a teaching tool and turn to his disciples and say, except a grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abides alone. And they would go, he takes common things. He's not this great orator. He takes common things and explains things to us and we understand better. Folks, grain and wheat and falling into the ground was made after the image of Christ, before the world was. God looked at his son. He didn't look at wheat and then say, I think I'm going to make you like that. You know, Jesus wasn't a really whippersnapper, sharp, you know, silver-tongued orator. Great with parables. That wasn't a parable. That was a fact. This is made after my all things, and by him and for him and to him were all things created, and by him all things consist. They find their meaning in him. And so, leaven doing what it does has nothing to do with, now don't mix in this sense, now don't mix in any bad stuff in a certain sense. Well, here's what we always say. Don't mix sin in. And there are scriptures that deal with leaven as sin. But folks, there are scriptures that deal with leaven as the kingdom of God. There are also scriptures that deal with leaven as the leaven of the Pharisees. There are also this scripture that's dealing with leaven very specifically. Therefore, your glorying is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leavens a whole lump? Purge out, therefore, the old leaven, that you may be a new lump as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Let us, Corinthians, Gentiles, keep the feast. Gentiles couldn't keep the feast before this. Now they keep the feast not by going to a temple or by going digging through their house and digging out all the leaven and only eating unleavened bread. That was the shadow. Now they purge out, therefore, the old leaven. Verse 8, therefore let us keep the feast not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So here he begins to speak of attitudes, speak of motivation, doing things with malice. That means I'm doing this to get back at somebody. I'm doing this, you know. And here's basically what Paul is saying. Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us on the 14th day, Nisan, whatever spiritually, however you want to put that. And we are now living in the ongoing, completed 7 days of unleavened bread. We have entered the land, and we're not going to eat of miracles, things that are outside us anymore, we are purging out the old, you know, and they were eating manna and murmuring. Do you remember? They finally got hacked off, and they said, we want quail. I want to eat quail. I'm sick of eating manna. Give us quail. And so God, you know, brought quail so much so, and they were happy. They just started eating. See, God brought a lot of quail, but he didn't make them eat it. But if you remember what the scripture says, they started eating, and they ate it so much it started coming out their nose. You know. And then the Psalms talk about it and says, you know, he gave them the desire of their heart but sent leanness into their souls. How many of you really, really want your way? I mean, you really want it. Well, God will give you desire, but he'll send leanness into your soul. And so, Paul is seeing this all. See, if I can, Lord, help me to paint this picture. Paul is not looking like we look. He's not looking at it like the church is a group of people that comes to a place, a building, and sits in pews, and we do church things. He doesn't see that at all. He sees everything in light of the true fulfillment. And he says, we are the fulfillment by Christ and in oneness with Christ. We're in the fulfillment of this. They entered a physical land, but we've actually entered into the fullness of the land, and we're eating of this unleavened one. We are partaking of Christ and filling ourselves with that, and we are purging out, verse 7, we are purging out any leaven. We are required to go on a search. And I shared this recently, but we're required to go on a search and look everywhere and check every compartment. Because sometimes we deceive ourselves. Amen? I mean, folks, the devil doesn't have that big a job. We deceive ourselves a lot. You know what I mean? Somebody goes, the devil's deceiving him. No, he ain't. The devil hadn't been around in a while. He's doing it himself. You know? We deceive ourselves. And you know how and why? Because we want things. Because we expect things. Because things have to be a certain way, and if I don't get it this way, then secretly, even if I hide, you know, because it talks about that this true fast, the true fast, in Isaiah 58, he says, you fast for wickedness and you fast for, you remember that? I mean, another example just like this one. You're fasting all right. He said, you're doing without and you're praying. And you're doing it so that you can get power, so that you'll look better than so-and-so, or so that you can be more spiritual looking, not so you can be with me, saith the Lord, but so that you can lord it over people and really think that you're somebody. And on and on and on. He gives all these reasons why they're doing it. And it's for wrong reasons. They're, you know, you think that just fasting is enough, just doing without food and praying. He says, you know, your heart. And then he says, this is a true fast, that you lay down your life for the poor and needy, that you give up your stuff and bless someone else. That's the Lamb of God. That's digging out all the leaven out of us so that we live by the unleavened life of Christ for 7 days, if you understand, from now on till completion. And it is complete. this is what we've entered into. And so, again, if I could only show you this picture, Paul doesn't see people sitting around in chairs. He doesn't see the real deal as what's happening right here. He sees the real deal as what is the fulfillment of. But to see that, to live that, to relate that way, you have to know the Word of God first, and then you have to know Christ in the Word of God. Because if you don't, you'll think it's just about visiting a church and living your own life, and God's going to bless you in your home, and God's going to bless your job, and you're just going to have this little life, and that's what it's all about. And God, our Father, does not view it that way. And so, and that gives us the right to, you know, have different things going off in us and stuff, and you know, well, we're all just human. He goes, my God, you're supposed to be digging around in your house. You're supposed to be looking under the bed everywhere. You're supposed to be searching it out and purging out the old, because you have entered the time of unleavened bread. You have come to the time of unleavened bread. It is, you are in the 7 days. You know. And so, imagine if every Christian lived that way, instead of, you know, the only time we look within is the preacher preaches a sermon on, you know, not giving or something like that. Well, maybe I hadn't been given enough. Or what, you know, it takes somebody else, and it has nothing to do with us searching for leaven, us living in the fulfillment of the feast, living in the fulfillment of it, being that. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with a religious world that we live in, and when somebody puts a little pressure on something and we see something dark in our hearts, we go, oh, forgive me of that. But it's a Christian thing. It's a religious thing, and it's living in a religious realm, and it is unaware how Christ fulfilled it all, and we're part of that. We're in it all. Do you see what I'm saying? And so the example there in Joshua, we just see it as, you know, well, we crossed over into the land, and now we're not gonna get manna anymore, because we lived off of miracles now, but now we're gonna live off of the dying seed of, well, there's a certain amount of truth to that. I do not, you know, take away from that. But the absolute truth of it was, these, at the same moment that they're entering in, at the same moment, you know, the Passover, they ate, they crossed over, and then the next day, on the 15th day, they start eating unleavened cakes from the land. And God says, no more. No more of the old. No more of the other. Purge out the old lump. Purge out the old stuff you used to live on. Purge out the old stuff that used to motivate you. Purge out the old stuff that was how you got by. Well, if I give up how I got by, I get by, I'll be very vulnerable. Anybody ever thought that way? Be honest. Anybody ever thought that way? You know, there are some people who have honed their abilities, whether it's manipulation, or intimidation, or whatever. They are little pockets in themselves of something that makes them superior, something that puts them above the average person. But it's not the Lord. And then they start coming face to face with the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and they go, what, you're telling me to give up the very thing that I would have been destroyed without what I'm using. I would have been, how about this, like everyone else. I would have been human. You know, and I don't want to be human. I don't want to be frail. I don't want to be exposed. I don't want to be like them. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And you're faced with it, and you're just going, there's got to be more to this than just give up my my superpowers. My superpowers. There's got to be some. Well, the answer is Christ. And it really is. I'm telling you this because I came to this years and years ago when I faced some things, and I went, oh, my God, you know, the things that the Lord is talking about right now, I didn't see them as sin or wrong. You know, they weren't sin per se. But I thought the things that he's talking about, I don't think I can make it without depending on these things. And the Lord said, you can't make it, but I can live in you. And I'll tell you what happened. It was like, you know, I use this example on other things, but it's a very good example. It's like, well, y'all are going to have to mess with your camera a little bit here. Well, maybe I can do it from here. It's like having stability right here, holding on. And the Lord is saying, now leave the old, leave the old, leave the old, leave what you has supported you, but it's not me. Leave that and come to me, being the pedestal here. Come to me and let me be your life, your strength, your support. And I'm sorry, because the camera situation, it's not really as real as I'd want it, because I would want to show you that while I'm holding on, I cannot reach the Lord. But when I let go, I still haven't reached the Lord. I come to a place that's in between. I no longer have the stability of the old, nor have I fully laid hold of the Lord yet. And it's one of the scariest places you come to, because it's like, this is stupid. I'm going back. Do you understand? I mean, there is this reality that this is worse. I am in a flux here. I'm freaked out, you know. But when you let go, you eventually do lay hold of the Lord. And the more you lay hold of him, you find a new strength that's not you. And it's not manipulation. It's not malice. It's not all of the wrong motivations. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not leaven or leaven. It's unleavened. It's Christ. And he was saying to me, purge out the very things that you have subsisted on. The things that you have subsisted on. Folks, you know, for some of you, this is just a teaching right now, but it will become a reality eventually. This is a hard area. It's a hard, I'm speaking only now from personal experience, but I believe that it's got to be hard for everybody. Because when you're first born, you learn things. You get you make it somehow. And most of the time it's not Jesus. We're not even born again. You know what I'm talking about? And for some people, it's being quiet and in the background. No, I'm serious. It's being real quiet and just being in the background. For other people, it's, you know, all sorts. The facets are so many, I cannot describe them all to you. There's no way. I have to trust the Holy Spirit to speak to you, that if this is the Lord and he's wanting to speak to you, then to speak. But it's a hard area, and there's only one thing that'll ever get you from that place of the old leaven to the place of him being 7 years, 7 days, a continual feast, you know. You remember the scripture says the Lord is a continual feast? Well, what do we get out of that? Well, we go, well, he's a lot of food. I mean, that's what we get out of it. You know, the Lord's a lot of food, man, that's cool. You know, it's like eating everything I ever liked, the best foods that I enjoy all the time. The Lord's just a content. Well, that's sort of a fleshly way of looking at it, isn't it? You know, I mean, well, the Lord's just the best foods that I could enjoy for my own flesh. No, it's the feast in the scriptures are these feasts, the feast of unleavened bread, the feast of Passover. You understand what I'm saying? They didn't have random, you know, random thoughts that just ran somewhere. They thought in line with what the Lord set up. Most Christians don't. They would, Most Christians have been taught to have absolutely no reason to look to the Old Testament. We are in the New now. Just read the New Testament. And of course, you've heard my explanation of that. Paul and everybody else got the New Testament that they wrote out of the Old. And so the Lord being a continual feast is you entering in, and when applied to the Feast of Unleavened Bread, is you entering into this place where you have been released from you. And when I say you, I mean, because, you know, that can mean anything. You have been released from your secret motives, your secret talents, your secret powers that have saved you and helped you and made you, helped you get by and made you and set you apart, if you will. And that give you some sense of superiority at times, you know? I mean, at times where you just go, well, I thank God I'm not like them. You know what I mean? I mean, that's real. There is a thought that says that. I thank God I'm not like them, you know? And, you know, you can have that both ways. That's a two-way street, you know? The Pharisees can look down on the, remember the guy praying and say, well, I think that's where that came from. He said, I thank God I'm not like this poor, you know, guy. I tithe, da-da-da-da, and all this stuff. But, you know, that the other guy could turn around. Now, what he did, the other guy, the poor man, what he did was he said, Lord, look on me the way you do the mercy seat. That's the actual Greek there. Look on me the way you do upon the mercy seat. Which, see, that would be in line with fulfillment of the old covenant, wouldn't it? Even to this day. But we might be just as evil as the Pharisee when we turn around and say, I thank God I ain't no stinking Pharisee. I mean, can you see how it's exactly the same thing? It's just the fingers are pointing in a different direction. You're just going, well, you know, you hypocrite, you know, all this kind of stuff. And it's saying, you know what? It finds superiority in looking down on the people who are looking down on them. You can actually get by with that. I've had people try to get us to join with groups of people who are all down on the church. And many of the people who've seen Jesus to any degree in the scriptures are all down on the church. Folks, if there's one person in that Baptist church over there or one over here, whatever, they, you know, and there may be more than one, might be a bunch, but I'm just saying they belong to God if they're born again. I was in those churches at one time. And I needed to hear the truth just like they do. So I don't side up against, you know, look down my nose. And, you know, and we get that a lot. You know, I hear it. People, well, you think you're superior. I'm thinking, now where are they getting? How could they possibly think that I think I'm superior when everything I'm saying is I'm not, I'm worthless, I should be crucified, I am crucified. Well, you're speaking with authority, so that must mean that you think you're something. You know, no, I don't. I really don't. I know I've still got a way to go. But I really don't think, not only me, I don't think we're superior. I'll tell you what, I think we got a long way to go in this place. I think we need Jesus desperately. I pray hard for you, myself, that we would see the Lord and that we would come out of some of the junk that we're in. I don't walk around thinking, I'm so glad that I've got the best people. You know, I could have got the worst. I did get the worst. However, Jesus ended up with the outcast and the lame and the halt and the, you know what I mean? He ended up with them. And that's because they recognize their need, not because they're better than the Pharisees. They just recognize their need for Jesus, you know? So I'm not ashamed of that. I'm not ashamed of being with David in the cave and it'd be a bunch of outcasts instead of in the big mansion, you know, the big kingdom house there with Saul. I'd rather be with Jesus and I'd rather be with people that at least know where the answer's found. That's found in him living in me, not me. So, anyway. So, we have entered this 7-day period. We have come to what should now be a continual feast, the continual feast of unleavened bread. We never leave. We never reach the edge of that and then step out and go, okay, now we can go back to hiding leaven in our house. Do you see what I'm saying? Now, you know, whew, 7 days are over, glory to God, you know, now let's go down to the store and get us lots of leaven stuff and hide it everywhere, you know. Yeah. And we'll wait till next year and then we'll hunt it down. But in the meantime, I have some under the bed when I need it, and I have some in the drawer over here, and I'll have some in the closet, and, you know, I'll be able to pull it out. If somebody messes with me, I've got some leaven. They want to mess with me, I'll leaven them back, dude. You know. It's sort of a Bruce Willis mentality, you know. I like Bruce Willis. I'm sorry, but the mentality is, you know, you mess with me, well, and I was raised that way. I was raised in Oak Cliff. I tell you what, I have in me a incredible monster that would love and is capable of taking heads off like that. But I also have one in me called the Lamb of God, this little bitty thing on a throne that says, you're dead. Honestly, I'm not joking. I am not joking. You know, people, you know, there are some people, not you because you know me, but there are some people who think, oh, Randy's just so peaceful and all of this. Well, I am in Jesus. I am. But I tell you what, Deb said she stopped off on the way and she talked with somebody about a truck, and it was not in this town, just, you know, in another town. And so he's talking about, well, I'd like to get this truck for my husband, but, you know, we can't afford it, obviously. And so she said, he said, well, where are you from? She said, North Dallas, you know, I went to Thomas Jefferson. He goes, oh, really? He said, where's your husband from? He said, Oak Cliff. And he went, what? What did he say? He must be a tough man or something, because, you know, I mean, just to be alive out of Oak Cliff is amazing. And that's the truth. There's a lot of truth to that. But, you know, there is a survival instinct that, man, you just feel somebody's coming at you, and you just go for the throat. I mean, you just feel it. You go for the throat before they get a chance to do anything. You know, you've heard my story. You know, I was skinny and little and everything else, so I believed in a, you know, equalizer. You know, some big old guy comes up and says, you want to fight? I said, sure, you know, but my eyes are looking around for a bottle or something. You know what I mean? He don't know that. He thinks it's just going to be a big old guy against, you know. And so, you know, I go, you sure you want to do this? Well, I reach my hand up. I'm reaching over here with another bottle. And you know, and I've done that before. And I'm not proud of it. I once was. I really once was proud of some of the stories I could tell you. But it's just Bruce Willis in me. It's not Jesus. And I tell you, I did. I went and saw that new movie, and I really liked it. And I tell you what, but I will tell, this is the honest truth. I can never live that way again. I can never be that way again. It starts to rise, and Jesus rises bigger now. And it's almost like, Lord, just like, for 5 minutes, let them experience the whirlwind. I mean, I've thought stuff. I'm not asking much, just 5 minutes, you know. And he says, no, you're my son. You purge that out. Now, that's not the words he always, but you purge out that leaven. Do not allow that in you, Randy. I want Jesus. I want my son in you. You are my temple. You are my feast. You are my hope. You know, that's the heart of the Lord talking there. That's the heart of the Father talking. And I'm not his hope, but you understand what I'm saying, that you would deny yourself, that you would love my son more than you love letting this stuff come out. you know. And it took years, and but the Lord, and I will say, I don't know that it'll ever be unleashed again. Honestly, I really doubt it. I mean, I see stuff like that Bruce Willis movie, and I think, I could do that. I mean, really, honestly. I mean, that's the truth. I mean, easily. I've got stuff in me. I'm crazy. I don't care if I live or die. I never have. I don't care. And that's what makes the person dangerous. In Oak Cliff, I'd say, I don't know karate, but I know crazy. You know what I mean? And you just get you just go crazy and just do the wildest things, man. And big guys, big strong guys, get afraid of you because they go, I don't know what he's going to do. He's capable of anything, man. He don't care if I, you know. I mean, I have been in fights where they beat the fool out of me, and I'd still get up and just keep going at them with every ounce I got. And then finally, they just got tired of beating on me. And I said, "My God, let's get out of here now. This guy's crazy," you know. You know, but it wasn't the lamb that was taking the beating. It was the crazy guy. It was the crazy guy. Well, I'm not, when that comes up in me, and when I say comes up, not out of me, up, I am ashamed of it because I know so much of what the lamb looks like now. I'm ashamed of it, you know, because I know that it's so opposite of him. Now, I know there's time to drive out the money changers and stuff like that, but that's not me. That's not Bruce Willis. That's still Jesus. Can I get amen from somebody? That's not me finding a vent for Bruce Willis in me. That's not, you know, but that's what we do. See, that's, if we did that, if we kept, you know, Adam down and we did that, but then there came a time when God called upon us to drive out the money changers, we would let that leaven come forth and call it God. Because we didn't purge out all the stuff, all the leaven. We got to do it. We got to learn to do it. We got to do it. He's not going to run around in our house and do it. He says, you're my house, you do it. You get it out. And we're not all, trust me, we're not all aware of all the leaven that's in us at this stage, are we? But we are in the 7 days of purging and getting rid of it and of only eating of the unleavened bread of his life. Well, we'll stop here and come back for class number 2 in just a few minutes.